subscribers. 100 is huge, guys. I didn't even ever imagine I would have 10 people that wanted to watch my videos. But I'm going to light that wood wick candle after I tap on this item for a minute and show you. I know I've got the red light effect going on, so I don't know if you'll be able to see it, but this is a huge candle.
city. I'm gonna
contentious cases in Chicago fire history does not concern a particularly spectacular or long-remembered fire. Although there was a tragic loss of 10 lives, including 8 firemen, the events which unfolded after the fire make the story chilling. Francis X. Levy, frank to his fellow firefighters, seemed melancholy, preoccupied as he raised the soap rag to clean the winter stir from another window in the firehouse at 13th and Oakley. It was Good Friday, April 18th, 1924. Levy was scheduled to work that day, and Easter, according to a recently posted work schedule. Levy was a 13-year veteran of the force dedicated to his profession, but disturbed by being away from his wife, Mary, and young children, June and Frank. They would understand, of course, that he didn't assuage Levy's gloom as he struggled to concentrate on cleaning the windows in the firehouse. The cold winter and late spring had taken its toll on the spirits of the men at Engine Company 107 and Truck Company 12. They were thankful that on this day they could leave the large red doors of the firehouse open as they went about the spring cleaning. Levy's friend Edward McKevitt was concerned about his comrade's dour expression. He walked over to Levy. "Was there a problem?" he asked. Levy's shoulders sagged. "This is my last day on the fire department," he replied. The soapy palm of his left hand rested on the window glass while he continued to wipe the window with the wet cloth on his hand. McKevitt was surprised. Earlier that morning, Levy seemed happy and content, talking about his future plans, whether it was working on the Easter holiday or concern about the big fire spreading in the Union stockyards. McKevitt didn't know. For several hours, a ticket tape type device, the Big Joker, it was termed, had been rat-tat-tat-tatting messages to the company about the 4-alarm stockyard blaze. To the company, the machine was the firehouse's link with the other firehouses. The stockyard's fire was extremely serious. Levy's company was far enough away not to have been called, but if the fire grew any worse, they might have to respond. And worse yet, if a blaze erupted in another part of the city, Levy's company might not be able to count on the backup support because of the large number of units already fighting the stockyard blaze. Suddenly, the Big Joker clicked out a message from alarm box 372, nearly 2 miles across the city. Several minutes later, Engine Company 107 and Truck Company 12 were ordered to report to a fire at Curran Hall, the imposing 4-story brick and stone edifice southwest of the loop. Frank Levy, Edward McKevitt, and their fellow firefighters clambered aboard the bumper and the truck for the harrowing ride through congested streets to the fire. There were few traffic lights in 1924. Intersections were scenes of impossible congestion. Streetcars, horse-drawn wagons, automobiles, and pedestrians all vied for the right away. The screaming fire engines left a trail of bewildered citizenry and frightened horses. Curran Hall was engulfed in flames. The building housed a number of small businesses. The heaviest smoke seemed to be pouring from the upstairs floor, the upper floors. Truck 12's crew was ordered onto the roof to chop hole to ventilate the upper floor. Firefighters could then reach the center of the fire. Frank Levy and the men on Engine 107 were told to make their way to the second floor. On their hands and knees, the men groped their way up to the stairwell through the choking smoke. There were no oxygen masks in those days. The men coughed and vomited all the way. Once they reached the second floor, the men had to take turns going out onto the fire escape for fresh air. The minutes passed slowly. It seemed the firefighters were gaining the advantage over the Suddenly, a cry rang out. "Get out! Get out!" Supervisors on the ground saw what the men inside could not. The outside wall was crumbling. Levy and the others scrambled to the fire escapes and started down, but it was too late. The wall caved in with a sickening crunch like a giant roll of thunder. Hoses split, sending streams of water exploding in all directions. Ladders snapped in two like so many matchsticks. The firefighters' equipment was buried under the avalanche of bricks and mortar, and the frantic firefighters making their way to safety disappeared under the lethal shower of building materials. Frank Levy never had a chance. He was only partway down the fire escape when the wall collapsed. Hours later, the bodies of 8 firefighters were pulled from the rubble. While almost all the firemen victims were battered beyond recognition, the face of Frank Levy was the only one recognizable among the fatalities. The next day, Holy Saturday, Edward McGivitt slumped in his chair as he tried to explain to his fellow firefighters what had happened the day before. It was not easy. 8 of his cohorts were dead, 20 other firefighters injured, 2 critically, and yet McGivitt found himself the most troubled by Frank Levy's premonition of death. "This is my last day on the fire department." As McGivitt glanced around the fire station trying to understand the senseless events, his gaze rested on washing the day before. His eyes focused on what seemed to be a blemish on the window. He rose and looked at it closely, the unmistakable outline of a man's hand, Frank Levy's hand. McGivitt clearly remembered Levy resting his palm against it as he wiped the window less than 20 hours earlier. "My God, it's Levy's hand," McGivitt muttered, almost to himself. The man who had been listening to McGivitt gathered around the strange impression. McGivitt told them of how he had seen Levy place his hand, his left hand, in that very spot only the day before. The image which remained on the glass of that of a left hand, its fingers outstretched, just the type of mark that would have been made by a hand drenched in water and soapy suds. McGivitt rubbed the window with a sponge from the bucket Levy had been using. The mark would not go away. The harder McGivitt wiped, the more obvious it became that Levy's handprint would not go away. Other men tried to wipe it off. They all failed. Ammonia, strong soaps, and even razor blades failed to dislodge the image. One firefighter went outside thinking the print was not on the inside of the window. His intense scrubbing was futile. By early the story of the firehouse at 13th and Oakley and its mysterious handprint is spread through the city, fueled by several newspaper stories. Soon, other firefighters, newspaper reporters, neighbors, and curiosity seekers showed up at the station's big red doors for a look at Levy's handprint. An expert from Pittsburgh Plate Glass Company, the manufacturers of the window, were called in to solve the problem. He used a special, highly reliable chemical compound to clean the window, but Levy's handprint remained. A city official compared the copy of Levy's handprint to the thumb mark on the window. He said they matched. As the weeks and months passed, a steady stream of curious continued to show up at the fire station. Firefighters regularly washed the windows, including Levy's handprint. Knowing full well the image would not go away, suggestions were periodically made to replace the glass, but the firefighters usually objected, saying it wasn't right to tamper with the unknown. Over the years, the firehouse, 13th and Oakley, saw dozens of firefighters stay within its walls and then go on to other assignments. Levy's handprint always remained. It was custom for older firemen to tell the story of Frank Levy to the new men. Newspaper reports occasionally resurrected the oddity, bringing a new horde of curious seekers. Curiously, Frank Levy's widow, Mary, and his children footsteps and became a fireman on April 18, 1945, the 21st anniversary of his father's death. Did the window pane actually contain Levy's ghostly handprint, or was the image a defect in the glass which, when viewed from certain angles, resembled a man's hand? It is impossible to answer those questions today. However, there's no evidence to suggest that the defect was ever noticed until after Frank Levy's tragic death. Some firemen were convinced the print was supernatural. Others suggested that Levy's frightening premonition of death caused a bodily chemical to mix with his perspiration, causing the indelible stain. No one has ever satisfactorily explained what caused the grim legacy of a dead fireman. And what happened to the window with Frank Levy's handprint? That is perhaps the strangest of all. On April 18, 1944, 20 years to the date on which Levy died, a newspaper boy threw a rolled up newspaper toward the firehouse. The missile struck Levy's window, shattering it in